India Foundation Management, and Mr. Saurya, Rajiv Lal, and other friends. Before going to speech, just I want to correct. I'm not from Chennai now, I'm from Delhi now. We never been in Chennai this. We moved to from Rajam to Bangalore, Bangalore to Delhi now. Other dignitaries, government leaders, corporate leaders, media people, other divine people here, and editors and journalists, good morning to all. I'm truly privileged to participate in the fourth India Ideas Conclave amongst such an intellectual gathering. I may say that India Foundation is doing a remarkable job by organizing India Ideas Conclave every year that brings together a luminary gathering of policymakers, public intellectuals from India and abroad. The theme of the conclave, Leadership 21st Century, is very apt in today's socio-economic dynamics of the globe. I have been asked to share my thoughts on what type of skills and role is required by the leaders in the 21st century. However, first we should understand as what type of environment we are living in the 21st century. My dear friends, earlier where we are living in a closed, protected environment, over the last few decades, globalization has taken prominence and connected the world. With the rapid advancement of technologies, world is coming closer each passing day and the interdependence of the countries has increased significantly. We are no more local citizens of country, we are all global citizens today. In fact, we are so much connected that earlier they used to say that if a USA sneezes, whole world catches cold. But today, any country sneezes, all other countries are catching cold. At the same time, we are witnessing regionalization with a few countries trying to protect their turf by putting visa restrictions, embargoes, trade restrictions, closing their territories for migrants, and other such regulations. Brexit is a classic example of this. With this globalization, regionalization happening at the same time, the world is getting big time confused. All this is creating an increasingly complex, uncertainty and volatile environment. If you see the dramatic turn of geopolitics, it is also making world more complicated. Recently, USA President Trump's approving the Jerusalem as Israel's capital, Saudi Arabia's internal war, North Korea's testing nuclear weapons, all such events create huge repercussions across the globe. Today, countries are not worried about military war. They are more worried for cyber war. It is said that North Korean government, through its trained hackers, are earning $1 billion per year by hacking. Very recently, there was a cyber attack on USA electrical grid. Just imagine if that would have been successfully, whole US economy would have come to standstill. With regards to the economic shift, we all know as how the regime of oil economy is almost perished and data economy has taken dominance. The advancement in technology is changing the economics overnight. These geopolitics and economic shifts are interlinked to great extent. For example, after oil demand is decreasing, oil-rich countries like Saudi Arabia are sitting on big-time economic challenges and trying to change their economic dependency from oil. Earlier, where they were lavish in spending, today all the costs have been curtailed. As a result, a lot of Indian workers are losing their job. This will also hit the remittance to India significantly. Friends, the globalization, regionalization, technological disruptions, cyber hacking, geopolitical tensions, economic shifts, all these have created a VUCA world, volatile, uncertainty, complex and ambiguity world. Forex, commodity, stocks markets are extremely volatile. people are losing jobs. As per the estimates, in the next few decades, 40% of the Fortune 500 companies will not exist. They will be disrupted by the technological advancement. Experts say that maximum life of corporates in this century is 20 years. Tomorrow, what is going to happen, nobody knows. This is increasing our stress and anxiety levels tremendously. Hence, we need altogether a different type of leadership today. In my opinion, there is a 7 elements will be crucial for the leadership, which are strong value system, greater flexibility and adaptability, frugality, ethics and governance, including growth and curiosity. The last one is very important, spirituality as inner excellency. Let me talk about this. First is strong value system. I firmly believe that if one has a strong fundamental values, then the core is unshakable. The mother of all values is humility. One needs to have a humility as the foundation of great leadership. Humility helps to master our ego. It generates excellent listening capacities, develops and nurtures great relationship with all the stakeholders, helps in a great team building and collaboration. Many companies have vanished because of the ego. Many countries are suffering huge setbacks because their leadership thought of my way is right way. According to David and Stephen, author of book Economics, 15% of the company's revenue generally suffers due to ego problems of the senior leaders, as they tend to take wrong decisions just for the sake of their ego. Jim Collins, one of the global reputed business authors, studied around 1,400 global companies to find out that 2/3 of the total companies failed to move from good to great because of the personal egos of the management. At GMR, we have 7 core values: humility, entrepreneurship, teamwork, and relationship. Deliver the promise, learning and inner excellency, and social responsibility, respect for individuals. With all humility, I can say that our value system helps us in making impossible tasks possible. We were able to deliver the world-class Delhi airport in record time of 37 months. When we took over the Delhi airport, was amongst the 10 worst airports in the world. Today, it is ranked as the number one airport in the world in its category. When you airport is privatized, the country is new for the airport, new this airport system. We are new for this. This transformation is not easy. It took a great passion and dedication to turn around. Our value system was paramount in this. Second is greater flexibility and adaptability. As I mentioned earlier, there is a lot of uncertainty in today's environment. Hence, one needs to be more flexible and agile in order to quickly embrace the change. Times are gone when individuals or corporates sat on their laurels. Fast is no more relevant. Change is the only constant. One needs to be continuously change its strategy based on the changing environment. If anyone develops complacency and does not change the strategy based on the demand of the situation, it will vanish in due time. We have numerous examples of this. Our Hindustan Motors, once the leader of the Indian car market, has vanished because it was not flexible and failed to adapt to the new technology and designs. Same goes with the world leader in photography, Kodak company. Since it failed to digitalize, it no more exists today. Hence, if one needs to sustain in these uncertain times, greater flexibility and agility is required. Third is frugality. Today is very essential to maintain the liquidity. We should be very careful in using our resources and prudent in maintaining the balance between essential use and extra usage. This will also help us in providing flexibility for any unfortunate situation tomorrow. A wise leadership of tomorrow demands conserving the resources, keeping the liquidity. Fourth is ethics and governance. Strong governance helps in creating a platform of trust, respect with all partners and stakeholders. For family business, I believe that strong family governance is very crucial as it leads to good corporate governance. Thankful our GMR family, we have a family constitution in place which is registered with SEBI. I am also glad to share that we have a dedicated department of ethics and intelligence which works very discreetly to ensure the highest governance compliance in the organization. An ethical leadership with a strong governance is what is required in the leadership of 21st century. Fifth is inclusive growth. For today's leadership, one big caution is that this has to be evolved from a personal ambition to larger vision, making a difference to the society with a view that my surrounding should grow along with me, else the leadership will not be able to sustain in the long term as there will be a big divide between the rich and poor leading to social chaos. At GMR, we have our foundation, GMR Varalakshmi Foundation. The mandate is to work with the local communities wherever our business are. Before starting any new project, first our foundation goes and study the requirement of the underprivileged local community, prepare a roadmap for them. Then only any business activity starts. We are running the foundation in the same professional manner as that of our business. We are working on the areas of education, healthcare, empowerment, and livelihood. Currently, foundation is working across 27 locations, including 2 in Nepal, 1 in Philippines. We also run 13 skill development centers across the country, which has become a role model today, and even government is learning our methodology. We are skilling more than 6,000 underprivileged youths every year with 80% of placement record. As of today, we have been able to train more than 60,000 underprivileged youths. One of the initiatives which is very close to my heart is the gifted children, where we adopt the poorest of the poor children and take care of their entire education and upbringing like our own child. We have almost 200 such children. The first batch of 10 students, which was personally selected by me some 15 years back, was a great success, with 4 children becoming engineers, 2 chartered accountants, and 1 girl selected for higher education in USA. Such is the potential of these children if given a platform to learn. I believe that education is the only platform to eradicate the poverty. Here in Goa, as many of you will know, that we are building a new Mopa Airport. Our foundation is very actively working with the local communities of Goa even when the construction has not started. We do not do this for any compliance sake. We have been doing this since last 25 years and recently celebrated successful completion of 25 years of our foundation. I can very humbly say that today CSR Act has been influenced by our foundation. Such is the influence on a much bigger sphere. Sixth is a curiosity. In today's time, no one can sustain without innovation and creativity. The only attitude leading to this is curiosity. What is required? A childlike curiosity, which is a state of active interest and genuinely waiting to know more about something. Curiosity allows one to embrace unfamiliar circumstances, learn and discover new things. It will enable one to learn all the time, as I believe that one has to keep learning till he or she reaches the graveyard. We must behave like a student until we reach our graveyard. The seventh element, which is very important to manage the stress, is spirituality and yoga. I call it inner excellence. Please do not confuse this with any religion. Our spirituality, yoga, and meditation is to know yourself. It helps in developing self-belief and fearless attitude, which is the core of any leader. For me, spirituality is essential, an inner journey which helps one attain mastery of one's own life, mastery of one's own life by managing thoughts, emotions, and situation. It reduces stress and provides strength to look upon adversity, not as a setback, but as an opportunity to learn. It helps in developing positive attitude in the most challenging times. Inner excellency also helps in developing higher degree of emotional quotient, that is called EQ, which is very important in the 21st century. Till some time ago, IQ was all that we required for success. However, now emotional intelligence, EQ, is much more important than IQ. In fact, most of the corporates across the globe, I'm talking to multinational companies, are looking for EQ rather than the traditional IQ. In hiring their leadership, EQ provides an individual the ability to adapt to every changing socio-economic environment. By managing physically, emotionally, spiritually, then only one will be able to manage the outside environment, family and society at large. It will provide a much required work-life balance. This way only one can effectively lead in this complex and uncertain world. To sum up, I would say that this interdependent, regionalized and technology-dominated world is going to be more and more complex and uncertain in the future. The leaders of tomorrow need to be more resilient with a great inner strength and extreme humility. They need to be flexible, frugal, ready to embrace the change, curious to learn new things, exhibits the highest form of ethics and governance, work with the philosophy of inclusion growth, and work on their inner development through spirituality and yoga. With these essential qualities of the 21st century, I am sure the future leadership will be able to successfully sail through the VUCA world. Before concluding, I must say that these seven elements of leadership, which I spoke about, and are not only limited to the 21st century, but will provide with one with timeless leadership. In fact, these traits of timeless leadership can be found in our Bhagavad Gita. That Sri M. has started this with the Bhagavad Gita, I think that's the right initiative, which I believe the Bhagavad Gita, it gives the universal leadership book containing the entire wisdom in its 18 chapters. Scholars, politicians, scientists, inventors, corporate leaders, many of the great accomplished personalities from across the world have referred and taken lessons from Bhagavad Gita. Though there are numerous examples, however, I would like to mention about Robert Oppenheimer, father of the atomic bomb. He admitted that Gita was one of the books that most shaped his philosophy of life. He studied Sanskrit in Berkeley to understand the Bhagavad Gita in its native language. Later on, Bhagavad Gita became the guiding light for Robert Oppenheimer, bringing out the leader in him successfully. Since last many decades, many top USA universities, including Harvard and other universities, are having management lessons and classes inspired from Bhagavad Gita. We in India should use the timeless leadership wisdom from our Bhagavad Gita to teach in our management schools. I'm aware that IIM Kochi is already doing that. All our business schools should adopt Bhagavad Gita for learning rather than just making it a religious book. With this, I would like to express my gratitude to India Foundation for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share my thoughts with such an eminent gathering here.